we're supposed to have a big storm tonight. So blesses us with his messages and just what he brings to our church very soon here. Let's begin in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this Advent season. We thank you for just all the different things that it means, Lord. As you came born as a baby to redeem us, Lord. We just thank you for that redemption that was bought with a price that we could not pay. It was bought with your blood on the cross, Lord. And because of that, we can celebrate this Christmas time, not just remembering your first coming, but also anticipating your second coming when you take us home to be with you forever in glory. We do lift up to you those who are sick, Lord. We think of Pastor and Judy. Pray that you'd bring them back to full strength, full health, Lord. Help their recovery process to go smoothly, as well as many others, Lord, within our congregation that are battling colds and flus and COVID and many other things, Lord. You know the needs, and we pray that you would work your healing as you will, Lord. We just pray your blessing tonight on Todd Westlake as he brings your word, Lord. Pray that it would be your words and not his, that you would speak through him, Lord, and pray that you'd prepare our hearts to receive that very word tonight. We pray this all in your name. Amen. I invite you to stand as we begin tonight. We're going to sing O Little Town of Bethlehem.
Chapter 1, verses 18 through 23. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace. He had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord has said through the prophet: "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for tonight. Thank you that you came as a baby, and in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Caleb. Let's continue to sing together. Hark the herald angels sing.
Thank you. evening, everyone. I want to thank you all for the opportunity to be here tonight and to bring the message. I would like to read from a very familiar text, especially at this Christmas time, and it is Luke 2, 1 through 7. If you would like to turn in your Bibles to that. At this time, the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken during Quirinius was governor of Syria. All returned to their own ancestral towns to register for the census. And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he was to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from a village in Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, to whom he was engaged, who was now expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to the firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no lodging for them. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this amazing gift. We just thank you for your way of doing things and not ours. I just pray now that as we look at another Christmas season, that you would let us see events, people, things that happen in your eyes, not ours, and that we'd be giving you the praise and the glory for everything in your son's precious name. Amen. Okay, full disclosure, I'm not a pastor. I am way out of my comfort zone right now. I don't mind public speaking. Preaching is not in my wheelhouse. And I do healthcare. For all of you know, I do orthotics and prosthetics. And in orthotics and prosthetics, it gets really busy this time of the year. People meet their deductibles, so it gives us the opportunity to work with more people. And we get to do some amazing things with people. And it puts more people that give me the opportunity to share with and to be a blessing to. And I am so thankful for that. But everything in my being was screaming to not do this. When I was asked by pastor, I tried to find ways to get out of it. My thinking was, is I'm just too busy. I don't have time for this. But every time I know that God blesses people who are faithful. And there's a reason that God asks us to do some things. And if we are faithful in those, whether we are good at them or not, I don't know what God has for you out of this. I've already experienced what God has for me out of it, a message for me that was I needed to hear. It is about, I struggle this time of year because of how busy it gets, with sometimes attitude and perspective. A lot of times I will go in, you know, like this year I'm on call Christmas Day. We're planning on hosting everyone at our house. Everyone's going to be over there, and when that phone rings and I have to go down to, you know, see someone at the hospital Christmas morning, the initial thing in my, when that phone rings is, really, I have to do this? But I have been blessed in the past, and I need to look back at history of patients that I've gotten to work with over that are really suffering, and God has sent me there to be possibly that light or that gift that day. I struggle with it, though, and this message is probably more for me than anything to look at. Another Christmas is coming up that I would have the proper attitude and perspective. And looking at, I am relieved as I started doing this Bible study, as I started looking into the scriptures, and I chose this particular one because of looking at the first Christmas and looking at it from a very human perspective of what is going on and how things happen. I love that about God and the scriptures. I love how he takes very, very ordinary people and does extraordinary things and gives them the ability to to step out in faith, even though the situation's very, very hard and is hard for them to understand why it would be done a certain way. And you see it throughout. I for many years I taught Sunday school and taught about David because I loved David because he was loved by God because he was faithful. He was human, and you got to see all his failings too. And we, each and every one of us, are the same way. We have those failings. We have those struggles. We have things or perspectives of how we think they should go without stepping back and going, God, how do you want to use this situation? And I ask you, what's your perspective of a perfect Christmas? What's it take? Karen could pull off a perfect Christmas if she hadn't married me and had three boys. You know, growing up with three brothers, a perfect Christmas, you know, consisted of not having to go to the ER, you know, or a broken bone or some other, you know, it was just, and all the furniture would survive because things would break out, fights would break out. I think Karen and I had some of our best fights over board games over Christmas time. But we create these expectations of what Christmas is supposed to be. And, you know, they're supposed to be that Norman Rockwell, you know, do we get them in our head that, oh, the table should be perfect, the food should be perfect, everyone should be loving on each other and encouraging the whole time. There shouldn't be any discussions about, you know, how things go wrong and politics shouldn't even come into it unless we all agree, you know. But it isn't. And the perfect Christmas is, I mean, to look at what God and how God pulled off that very first Christmas using Mary. I mean, to use a young lady, he decides to choose a teenage girl who probably, you know, she studied, and from her song and from some of her, the words that she's written that she has quoted, you can tell that she was in the Jewish synagogue learning, or learning of it, learning of some of the prophecies, learning of what it meant to be, you know, looking for that Savior. And at the time this was going on, God had been silent for 400 years. It had been about 400 years in the Old Testament, and they hadn't heard from, you know, in this one-on-one relationship where God had kind of been silent to the people, to the Jewish people. And to pick Mary out of it, a teenage girl, a virgin who is betrothed to Joseph, you know, here's a young lady who is terrified. And in Luke 1:30, the angel comes to her and, you know, says, you are found favor with God. You will be the one. And her first thought is, me? Why me? Why would you pick me? And she's greatly afraid. You know, either the responsibility or, you know, seeing the angel and knowing that they have been looking forward to a Savior and that she would be the one that God chooses. It's like, don't be afraid, Mary, the angel told her in Luke 1:30, for you have found favor with God. Mary's probably over the moon. The thought that she is about to be the one who would bring salvation to the world, that God has chosen her and found favor, it is amazing. But now Mary is betrothed. So now, to break this down into a very human level, here she's betrothed, and now she's got to go to Joseph and say, Joseph, yeah, by the way, I'm pregnant, and tell the story about an angel. And I can't even imagine. It's like Mary, how she felt about it was recorded. And it's recorded when she went to go visit Elizabeth. And her song about she must have had a clue of what was about to happen. It is an amazing part of Scripture just to see her heart and to see why God chose her. Why I'm so honored that the mother of my Lord should visit me. When I heard your greeting, my baby in my womb jumped for joy. You are blessed because you believe that the Lord would do what he said. And Mary responds with this amazing song going 46 through 56. Mary responds, "Oh, how my soul praises the Lord, how my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he took notice of his lowly servant girl. And from now until all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One is holy, and he has done a great thing for me. He shows mercy from generation to generation for all who fear him. His mighty arm has done tremendous things. He has scattered the proud and the haughty ones. He has brought down princes from their thrones and exalted the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things. He has set the rich away with empty hands. He has helped the servant Israel and remembered to be merciful. For he made the promise to our ancestors, to Abraham and the children forever." Mary stayed with Elizabeth about 3 months and then went back to her home. And enter then the discussion with Joseph. Joseph, again, as the human part of it, Joseph is told that Mary's pregnant. Mary comes to him. They're probably not even supposed to at this point even being seen until they're married together. She's been betrothed. Tells Joseph that she's pregnant and tells him the story. And Joseph, like, he is not believing it. It's very obvious that it's like, yeah, right, okay. We're gonna do this quietly, because he was a man of honor. He easily could have made this very public and very messy. He's decided that, you know what, okay, it's not right, but I'm not going to make this a public thing. We're not going to shame you. We're just going to divorce you quietly. And that's when Joseph then has the dream. And he is made aware of, in Matthew 1:19, Joseph, to whom she was engaged, was a righteous man, and he did not want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement quietly. He's done with it until the angel comes to him in a dream. And then he realizes that this is of God. And then the first Christmas is about to happen. So he's decided that, yes, this is how it's going to be. She's 9 months pregnant, and they have to make the long trip to Bethlehem. So from Nazareth to Bethlehem is about 70 miles as the crow flies. It's 90 miles, the route most likely that they would have taken. They would have taken down, gone along the river, and then all the way up into Bethlehem. And everyone was doing this. And I can't imagine how hard that journey would be. To make that journey of 90 miles, she's 9 months pregnant. I've never been 9 months pregnant. I have some personal experience with it, and at no point did I see it was very comfortable, and that, hey, honey, for Christmas, I think what we should do is we should get a donkey and maybe take a 90-mile walk and go visit my family, which would be bad enough. It's like, because that's where they're going. They're going to Joseph's family. I'm like, okay, and walk 90 miles. Yeah, it'll be great. We'll have a good time. And along that route, I mean, they estimated that it probably would have taken them about anywhere between 4 and 7 days, you know, and I'm thinking being pregnant is going to take it a little bit longer. You're going to take it a little bit slower. The route along the river, there's no rest stops. There's no restaurants. There's bathrooms everywhere. That's the best part about that. But the first Christmas, so you're going into this first Christmas, and you have just walked, or you are walking 90 miles. I don't think anyone's smelling fresh. So I don't think you're getting there, and you're going, wow, you guys, thanks for showing up. You know, I'm thinking that 90 days in, or, you know, 90 miles, 4 or 5 days in the wilderness, packing the provisions to be able to make that trip, to try to make that trip. I'm thinking, if I'm Mary or Joseph, I'm having doubts. Is this really the Son of God? Is this what God, is this is how I'm going to bring salvation to the world? Make me walk 90 miles? Wait a second. This is your son. Wouldn't you assume in man's world, I'd be assuming that, yes, they're going to set her up in the temple, you know, set aside a spot for her. This is God's son that's coming. No, we're going to hike you 90 miles. We're going to walk you all the way down to Bethlehem. And it is amazing to see how God uses events. So there's at least seven prophecies that talk about the birth of Christ. And I love seeing that Mary and Joseph, their faithfulness to go, okay, God, this is where we are. This is what you want us to do. We are going to be faithful. We are going to follow. There's a census going on, and we have to do that. I don't believe that they're knowing that this is fulfilling prophecy. I don't think Mary and Joseph are going, oh, good, the census is going, that works out perfect. We'll be in Bethlehem. The baby's supposed to be born in Bethlehem. This will be great. And all the other prophecies that came to be. God has an amazing way of using the people around and the circumstances, even when we can't see them, to fulfill his goal. Some of the prophecies, and it's amazing, you know, that it would be a descendant of Abraham around 1500 to 1300 BC was fulfilled in this birth of Christ. The descendant of Jacob, approximately 1300 years BC. The prophecy of a virgin birth, 740 BC. Prophecy that how the child would be born, 700 years beforehand. The prophecy of the Messiah's time, also 600 years, and that he would be all those prophecies. And I love stuff like this where you go, it is such a God thing. There's Peter Stoner, astronomy professor. Of course, someone always goes in and goes, okay, what are the odds? What are the odds that, you know, one person would be able to fulfill all these prophecies that Jesus did? And it comes out to this super huge number. And that's great, 10 to the, you know, 0000, which if you know math, then you'd appreciate it. I like the side where they go, okay, Stoner illustrates the chances this way. Suppose all of Texas was covered in 2 feet of silver coins. All of Texas. Texas is huge. I've driven through there with Wayne Flone. We got halfway through, and I'm like, whew, we're to Texas. And we're driving for about 8 hours, and I'm like, we must be done driving through. No, there was another 8 hours. It is huge. So all of Texas, 2 feet deep with silver coins, with one coin being marked with a red dot. Then a blindfolded man is dropped off and told to walk about where he wants, and he must pick up the right coin on the first try. That is the chances of this just being random, that there is to fulfill the prophecies the way God did, and the way he used common people to do that is amazing. God can use any situation. COVID's been terrible. Everyone's going crazy because of it. We are in the healthcare industry, I'm over it. I'm so tired of it. I'm so tired of dealing with it and all the stuff that comes with it. Very frustrating. But the upside of COVID is my mom, during COVID, Eric's church decided, my brother's church down in Zumbrota, decided that they were going to broadcast like what we've been doing every Sunday. And my mom and dad started watching my brother every Sunday. And they probably wouldn't have done that had COVID not come, if the church hadn't had to go online like that. And because of that, my mom came to a saving faith. You know, so in times that you go, God, why is this going on? I can be thankful because of the COVID experience, because of what it means to know that I'll be able to see mom again. You know, and God can do that. And God, you know, Christmas is one of those amazing things where God has given us an amazing gift of a Savior. And it's so easy to lose focus of that because of all the other stuff we have going on. Work, how busy it gets, getting gifts. I'm calling on all of us to think about that. Think about changing things up. Change about your focus. Look at things in that you do and have done for years that do nothing but cause you heartache or cause you just like anxiety. I love that, you know, we have gotten pretty good about it lately, and I mean we've had some fun things, and we've pared it down where, you know, we exchange names, and the brothers may have ruined that one year when all the brothers exchanged names, and then we secretly met and decided that we were just going to buy each our own gift and put the other brother's name on it. That, you know, so when we were all opening it, they're like, this is exactly what I wanted. But you know what? It made it fun. And it's just like, it was fun to be with family. It's fun stories. It's finding ways to deliver that gift of Jesus to people. And how far are we willing to walk? What are we willing to do? What faith steps are we willing to step out on and say, God, use me? Being on call this year again, I mean, I tell of this great story. I had a pastor who had lost his leg, just a dear Christian man who was just a blessing to me. And I got to work with him, and he lost his leg above the knee, and it was coming up on Christmas time, which is super busy for us. And he wanted more than anything to have the prosthetic so that when his grandkids came Christmas Eve, that they would see him standing. You know, and it was such a blessing. We were working terribly long hours. Kyle was busting. He stayed up all night to get it done for this guy. We delivered it Christmas Eve morning, and it was such a blessing to see those pictures. You know, and it was taking time away from my family, but again, just trying to be faithful to what God has for you. And no one has a perfect Christmas, but can you make a way to give that gift of Jesus? You know, that's what all that matters. December 26th, that's all that matters. How were you able to present Christ to someone? And that amazing gift that God's given us. That's attitude and perspective. If we can be thinking about just what would God want, and that first Christmas wasn't perfect, and this Christmas, everyone, I want to warn you, it's not going to be perfect. But it could be amazing. So would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. Just thank you for the amazing gift of your Son, that only through him and through the vessels of Mary and Joseph, and how you fulfilled so many prophecies through your Son. I just thank you for that gift. I just thank you for the eternal life that comes from him and the way he was willing to love and to die on the cross for each one of us. Heavenly Father, it all becomes possible because of the way you decided to save this world. I just thank you for this. I thank you for this Christmas season. I just pray that you would open our hearts to people around us. Give us your vision for the situations that we could step back, times when we're super busy or things seem like they're going wrong, and find the positive in that situation and find a way to glorify you. We know that in any situation you can be glorified, Heavenly Father. We just pray that we would change our perspective and our attitude during this time of the year, that it would be all about you, and just that you would use us for your glory in your Son's precious name.
Thank you so much, Todd, for sharing with us this evening. Before we close this evening, let's sing again. We're going to sing Joy to the World, hymn 18. Be up on the screen and in your bulletin insert. Let's stand together. The darkness of this world, sometimes even the darkness in our own lives, Lord, that your light shines through. We thank you that even as was spoken in the Christmas story often, that in the midst of darkness, a great light shines among us, Lord. We thank you that you are that great light. We thank you that you are a light that guides us. We pray that you would guide us as we leave from here, Lord, whether that's to share your good news, the gospel of your good news to the world around us, Lord. We pray that you would also go with us as we drive home as well, Lord. We know that there's a potentially bad weather coming, and we pray that you'd keep us safe as we go from here, Lord. And we just glorify you for who you are. We thank you for sending your Son, and just pray your blessing on us this Christmas season.